Shabbat Shalom. We are now in the intermediary Shabbat between Yom Teruah, it's called Rosh Hashanah, and Yom HaKippurim, or Yom Kippur. This is a very important time of the year. During these 10 days, we call it the Yamin Noraim, or also the Esere Yamin Teshuvah. The 10 days of returning to God. And Vayelech is a very special parasha, very short, only one chapter, but full of meat and meaning. Here, Moshe Rabbeinu is going to talk about his years in the he's going to live, and he's going to tell us, I'm going to live 120 years, and this is the time that I'm going to die, or I'm going to pass away. I'm going to go to sleep with my fathers. No, he is not going to be allowed to go to the promised land, and the only thing that he's going to be allowed is to go to see from higher the mountain the promised land that was given to Israel. Can you imagine how hard it was for him not to be able to go with his own children to the final destiny? He was only at the door, at the shahar, at the gates of Hairex. And then he say, do not worry. Our Creator has given you another leader, Yehoshua. Very interesting name. You know, his name was Hoshea, and he himself extended his name from Hoshea to Yehoshua. Why? Because with that name, Yehoshua, he was implying that the salvation comes from the Creator. By the way, Yehoshua, the nickname for Yehoshua is Yeshua, what is the name of our great teacher, rabbi, and prophet, Yeshua. And then here, he say that he tells to Yehoshua, please, don't be discouraged. Totally the contrary, be strong, because our Creator is going to be with you to the end. He won't abandon you. He's going to be with you. And this idea, we need to keep it, all of us together, because be strong and courageous. For you shall come with these people to the land that the Lord swore to them. No, be strong and courageous. This is something that when we ended every book after reading, we say, Hasak, Hasak, Beni Hasek. Strong and strong, you know, be strong. Be courageous. Do not dismay, because I am with you always. After that, he is going to talk about that we are going to we are going to write a song, but in this preamble, he is going to prophesy, and the prophecy is that Israel is going to fail our Creator. You know, this has caused sometimes problems to certain sages and to understand a little bit about the determinism versus free will. It is all predetermined, or we have free will. And it's very obvious that we have free will. What is so difficult to understand is the omniscience of the Creator. He is the Creator of everything. He knows everything. For him, there is no past, present, or future. Everything is already there. It is for us human beings that we are tied and limited by time. Is that for us looks like that maybe he is determining us what we are going to do. But here is the secret for me in the understanding about this part. Our Creator is omniscient. But at the same time, he gives to each one of us the free will to act and to do our own things. I have been talking to you about the Bechira Choshi, free will. And I have been talking to you about this term in this way. That means to be responsible and to respond for your own acts. Today, in this new world, in this world that we are living, now we literally, we have eliminated the word sin, S-I-N. Now we do not talk about sin. We talk about crime, you know? And interestingly enough, I want to tell you that changing from sin to crime, it is also that we have made our society more secular. And making more secular, we have taken our Creator out of the picture. He's not any longer valid in our way of behaving and thinking. When we talk about crime, basically we talk about human rights. What the human rights is, for example, the basic human rights. What are the basic human rights? The right to live, the right to have a possession, you know, the right to think, to live, you know, basic rights. Then the laws, the human laws that we have, it is to respect the human rights. Only the human rights. For example, you shall not kill, say the Torah. For the people who do not think about sin, only about right, to kill another person is a crime. Very different from the Torah. And the Torah has nothing to do with the crime, has to do with the sin. What is the difference? In the secular society today, a crime means that you have broken the human rights of somebody else. For that reason, you are punished. That's all. But in the area of looking from the perspective of our Creator, killing is a sin. What is the difference? A sin is a transgression directly against the Creator. Why? It's not because it's a human right, but it's because the Creator is the giver of life. And each one of us, without exception, we have received his ruach. He has breathed upon us, and he has given us life. That life is divine. That life comes from him. The life doesn't come from the so-called theory of evolution. That life doesn't come from the theory of the quantum leap, that suddenly one day, you know, certain inorganic materials, plum, jump and they become organic, and plum, they become life. No, this is our Creator blowed upon our nostrils, and he, being mud, being dust, we became alive. That life, it is because we have been made to his likeness and image. And this is why life is sacred. Then when you take the life of someone, you are going against the Creator. Sadly enough, just this last week, there was in the United States, among the vice presidents, there was a debate. And almost at the end of the debate, the question came about abortion again. You know, both of them, the vice presidents, supposedly are very religious people. And I'm going to emphasize the word religious. And each one of them want to tell you that the religion tells them that to kill, to abort is killing and is wrong. They both accept it. What was the difference? One was very liberal, religious person, who he say, well, that is something personal. How many times I have heard that? My religion is personal, you know, and doesn't need to interfere with the rest of the humanity. I cannot impose my belief to others. Okay, from the other side, the others say, I believe in the sanctity of life. Well, for me, it was obvious who was more correct, if we can call it this. You see, I like it or I don't like it. There are certain things that are right and they're wrong. Maybe it don't fit my way of thinking, and maybe they don't fit my lifestyle. But they're wrong. And when they're wrong before God, that is transgressing God's teachings. That is a sin. And maybe today in society could be right. You see, today you can make a law that abortion is right. But it doesn't matter how much the men change the law from the teachings of the Creator to the human teachings, won't make it right. A crime is a crime. You see, in the scriptures, from the beginning say, the life begin at conception. By the way, all the scientists today, they know that that's true. That's no revelation. Do you know that they know that at the moment that there is conception, the fertilization that we call it, the egg with the seed of the man, and they come together, in that moment that they come together, there's nothing else that can be done to that union. And the only thing that the mother is a container. It's an incubator. And the only thing, this life is totally separate from the mother. Has her own heart, her own life. The only thing is that cell that start growing, and they call it fetus. I don't like that term. They call it a baby. Just start growing. And the only thing that does in that moment after conception is growing and maturing. But the life is there. Brains and everything. Everything is there. Heart, everything. You know that at the 8 days of conception, they can already sense the heart beat. They know that. The scientists, they know that. But why they trying to talk about even late abortion, late termination? Because for convenience, it's all convenience sake. When the woman say, it's my body, and I have the right to do whatever to do, okay, she's right, it's her body. But the baby that's inside her has nothing to do with her body. It's totally another human being. But we are not strong enough or honest enough, even for this man who said that he was very religious and he believed in the sanctity of life, but that was the decision of every woman. And then they accuse that somebody who is against abortion and is pro-life is anti-woman. How can you believe that? This is sin. Even that is no crime for human beings, before the eyes of God, is a crime. Interestingly enough, you want to know, in most of the synagogues, at the end of Yom Kippurim, they read certain verses. And one of the verses that are going to be read is Vayikra, Hasefer Vayikra, the book of Leviticus, that's chapter 18. And what is the chapter 18? It's about the relationship that cannot be done between men and a woman. And not only they mention about that you cannot have a relationship with the wife of your father, or with your sister, or with your aunt. You know, they have a series of relationships that cannot be done. But also at the input, men cannot lay with a man. Very clear. The Torah say that. It's not my, the young religious fanatic and I invented. That's it in Torah. Oh, the Torah is, that is an obsolete book. It's not any longer good. That people say that. And then talks about the woman. And in the woman, put even the lowest of the lowest, the head, talks about bestiality. Today, because we are so open-minded, so free thinkers, so evolved, now it's not what is important about the principles of the Torah, but what is important, what is my convenience. And humanity is failing. And because humanity is failing, what we are doing? We are self-destructive. We are destroying ourselves. Then, this time of the year, when we talk about, and we talk among each other, and when we, in this precious time, we say, we start with Lashana Tova Umetekag, that Happy New Year, have a good year, and be sweet. Then we continue with Lashana Tova Tikatevu. You know? Now that you have a good year and your name be written. At this time, we say among each other, Gemar Hatima Tova. Then your name be sealed in the book of life. All of us, we talk about hoping that our names will be in the book of life. And there are two books, the book of life and the book of death. And the book of death, already, according to our sages, they tell us that the tzaddiks, the tzaddikim, the righteous men, they're already, their book, their names are written in the book of life. And the evil people, already, their names are written in the book of death. There's nothing that you can do with them. That's already done. But us, the great majority, we are neither there, there, or here, you know? And we need to look for, make the way to be written in the book of life. Now, how can you be written in the book of life? Interestingly enough, there are religions that basically they tell you that the way that you're going to be written in the book of life is when somebody else pay for your mischievings, misdoings, or your sins. Somebody else. Because you cannot pay for your own sins. It's impossible. They make you believe that you are handicapped. And because you are handicapped, God is not that evil to make you pay for something that you cannot undo it. And then what he does? He creates means or ways in order that he take you out of the hook. Basically, he is going to make a very big deal. And he himself is going to sacrifice himself. He's going to die for you. He's going to pay for your sins. And honky-dory, you are free. But what the Torah teach you? The Torah teach you, I mentioned to you already in the Devarim, where it says the sins of the father cannot be put on the sons, and the sins of the son cannot be put on the fathers, and everyone is responsible for their own sins. Not only the Devarim, but we have in Ezekiel and we have in Jeremiah and the prophet that they're going to tell you the same thing. What is talk about that? It's called personal responsibility. This is what are today bring us to this moment. You can choose a wishful thinking that somebody else is going to pay for your sins, or you deal with your sins. You choose. You know, all of us, we would like the easy way. And what is the easy way? The only thing that you need to do is to repeat three words, and now I am saved, and I put my sins to somebody else. And that somebody else pay for my sins. Now I am free. That's all I need to do. The only thing I need to do is to believe. The rest is up to him. Other people, other religion, they believe, you know what? This life is worth for nothing to live for. The only thing is better, give yourself as a martyr, blow yourself or kill yourself or kill other people, and then let it then kill you, and you go to paradise and you enjoy 72 virgins and all the good stuff. You know, what a wonderful religion. But biblical Judaism is the only one that teaches you. No way, Jose. You need to respond for your own things and sins. You need to put the face. You need to be confronted. You are going to be judged for that. And then how I can make my name written in the book of life? That is Yom HaKippurim that teaches. We need to afflict our souls. That is what the Torah teaches, or that is the translation. But a more literal translation, and to give a better understanding, it is, you shall make your soul poor. You know, not long ago, I was reading again the beautiful Sermon on the Mountain by our Messiah, Rabbi Yeshua, our Messiah. And then he started with the blessedness or happiness, depending how you, the Ashrei, he started. And he said, blessed are those who are poor of spirit, because they are going to inherit the kingdom of heaven. The third term, poor of spirit, is the same term that is used in Yom Kippur. You need to be poor of spirit. They translated, you need to afflict your soul. And they translated, you need to fast. And we in Yom HaKippurim, we fast. But if you read very carefully, Yeshayahu 58, he's going to tell you, why you fast for nothing? You fast doesn't have any value. Because fasting doesn't put you in the book of life. What puts you in the book of life is making your spirit poor. And what it means, making your spirit poor, or afflicting your spirit, to reckon with your own self, and to face our Creator, and say honest to Him, very humble, recognizing that you do not have escape, and you don't have excuses. You recognize what you have done. You accept it. And then you start the way back to Him, Shuba. The way back to Him. And how you will start the way back to Him? By acknowledging, confessing, and reparation. You need to repair the thing that you have done wrong. How many things that we have done that cannot be repaired, but He can repair it when we go to Him. and is the reality of true teshuva. This is what it means afflicting your soul. Why you afflict your soul? Because you need to go deep in yourself and see all the mugre, and what do you call it in English? The schmutz, the ugliness in your soul. And the only one that can clean that is Him. Blessed be His name. No animals, no other sacrifices, nothing else is between Him and you. That's the true teshuva. Oh, we love that somebody else cleans me. Oh, I love that somebody else pays for me. Oh, I love that somebody else goes through the problem and I go free. Oh, don't worry, I'm going to kill myself and I'm going to go to the paradise. No, you cannot run away from our Creator. You can hide, because He's going to find you. You can run, but He's faster than you. There is no way of escapism. And what the religion they teach you? Escapism. To escape from the reality and from the responsibility of the believer. Then, here comes the true man. Yeshua said, blessed are those who are poor of spirit because they inherited the kingdom of heaven. If you translate it in a regular language, you will understand this. Happy are going to those people who humble themselves before God and they acknowledge who they are because they are going to be in His presence. That's it is. Do you want to be in His presence? That means you want to be written in the book of life. You don't need to run. You need to face it. This is responsibility of the Creator, of the believer. It is my desire that during these days that call the days of return, the terrible days, just before we get to Yom HaKippurim, and we practice now by tradition, fasting. And people say, Rabbi, why you don't believe that fasting is there? Why do you keep fasting? To me, very, very good, because as part of the community, I want to be with my community. And at the same time, I want to show them that it's not the fasting, but it's my relationship with Him. I pray that all of us, we follow the Creator and we don't follow men. I pray that all of us, we understand about acknowledging our faults is becoming being responsible for our actions and not blaming somebody else for what we have done. In the society today, crime, and they don't understand what is sin. Crime is always justified by men. They try to look excuses why they do what they do. The abortion is because the woman has the right over her body. All these sexual aberrations is because men have the right to do whatever they want to do with their bodies in their life. It's okay. They can do that. And I always say this, publicly and privately. The same way that these people, with their aberrations, they want to impose the way of life or to be accepted, they need to respect us who do not believe in that way. And instead of killing each other, because we don't have the right to kill anybody, life is sacred, you know, the only thing I can say to these people, it is, you can do whatever you want to do, but you are going to face one day the Creator, as I need to do it. I'm sorry that I cannot accept your behavior, but at the same time, I cannot eliminate you. I don't have the right. But please, the same way that you are pushing me to respect you, you need to respect me too. Because it's two ways. Doesn't mean that you accept my way of understanding, and doesn't mean that I accept your way of understanding. Then we agree to disagree, because at the end, we have a great judge, the only one, our creator, who is the one that is going to look at us. It's my prayer that we will be ready for this Yom Kippur, and that we can have a time with him in which we can honestly open our souls, open our minds, open our life, acknowledging the thing that we have done wrong and to try to make it right. May the Lord bless you and keep you. And what we say, that we keep praying that we have not only an easy fast for the day, but that we pray that during this time, we can become closer to him, and we will be able to have the sense that our names really are written in the book of life. Shabbat shalom.